Johnson, if that could have took out the entire lead pack, the new leader at the finish line will be Roberts. An unbelievable comeback there.
That was unbelievable. The White Kenny went above Brady Spencer.
Hi, guys. Welcome to another episode of Kramer's Classic Cycles. I'm Kirby Kramer. Today I have something really fun to share with you. We have two, not one, 1984 Yamaha RZ500s. These were legend back in the day and still pretty much are. They're a V-twin put together to make two V-twins. So in essence, you've got two cylinders like this and two cylinders like this at 50 degrees, producing about 80 horsepower in the street level trim. These were similar to the OW70 that Kenny Roberts won several world championships with in the early 1980s. Yamaha built these in limited production to celebrate those victories. I believe these were only made in 84 and 85. They make about 50 pounds of torque. They weigh about 430 pounds dry, about 475 all up, and they are really a hoot to ride. Very broad power band, and they have a counterbalancer in them, so they're actually quite smooth. Both of these bikes have JL pipes on them, one in stainless, and one's painted black, as you can see. The bike with the black pipes on it also has an Ohlins rear suspension system. So we're gonna go through a little bit on these bikes and then pull off some of the fairings and also show you some of the magic inside. And then we'll go out and ride them. Really a treat to see two of them going at the same time. If you listen carefully, at certain settings, you can hear the engines synchronize. They're harmonizing at the same speed. Power band's pretty narrow. It doesn't really make any power until about 6,000 RPMs, and the sweet spot's about 7 to 10. That's where this really gets going. So some of you may not know, these bikes were never imported into the U.S. That's because smog restrictions started kicking in. In 1984 and 85, they brought in the RZ350, its little brother, but Yamaha chose not to import these into the U.S. These two bikes are Canadian point of entry. So it's interesting, if you look at both of them, the speedometer is in kilometers per hour. Both of them have pretty low miles. Also up in front here, space is kind of tight. It does have oil injection. So there's an oil injection tank on the left and a radiator reservoir on the right. Both of these bikes had the Yamaha power valve system, and you can hear that kick in. It goes and cycles when you first turn the key on. The rest of it's pretty standard, where you've got a tachometer, turn signals, high-low beam, low oil light, and of course, radiator temperature. A lot of cool things on the RZ500. One of the most notable things about the RZ500 is the perimeter steel frame. These were mild steel, and they cradled the entire engine. The Japanese version actually had a handmade aluminum alloy system, which saved about 30 pounds. That was to compensate for the fact that the Japanese version was detuned to about 65 horsepower. These bikes were reportedly somewhere in the mid-80s. On the rear end here, you'll see it's an 18-inch mag wheel. This one's been powder-coated black, and it's got a unique rear disc on it. You can see the rear disc is vented, and it's actually in three separate pieces, so it can flex easily. The idea was to reduce weight and increase heat dissipation. One negative I found with these discs is at this age, they all tend to warp a little bit. They're still very effective, but you get a little wobble for some reason on the rear brakes. This bike, along with many I've seen, has the JL pipes. They're a handmade work of art, all hand welded. I believe this one's stainless steel. They're made in Czechoslovakia. In a minute, we'll pull off the cowlings and you can see the artwork that went into making these pipes. Something else that's kind of interesting, a little detail, is the Kickstarter. These bikes are easy to kickstart, but it has a detent Kickstarter that goes back, opens up, you kick the bike, and on a normal bike, you just close it and be done, but this hits your knee. This one locks forward, which is a nice feature. Moving our way around to the front, Yamaha was fresh off of winning the 1984 Grand Prix. They did the vented front discs on the front, and they also went with an anti-dive front brake system. This was unique in that when the front brake was applied, it would actuate a valve that was supposed to restrict the dampening and the compression on the fork to stop the front end from diving under hard braking. My experience is that it didn't really work very well, and it took away from some of the responsiveness of the front brake. You can see up here there's a little adjustment on it as well. The front wheel in itself is unique. It's 16 inches, so it was a smaller front wheel designed to make the bike more nimble. And you can see just how wide this front tire is. It's as wide as some rear tires on bikes of the day. The whole bike is, of course, fully fared. In a few minutes, we'll get into pulling off the cowlings and show you what it looks like on the inside. It featured clip-on handlebars, which are made of hand-welded steel, typical gauge package up front. The fuel tank is hinged, so when the seat and rear cowling is removed, the fuel tank, we'll show you in a minute, flips up like this. That would give you access to the upper cylinders for changing the spark plugs and for doing some minor adjustments. The exhaust pipes actually run through, the top exhaust pipes, run through the seat area here, and they crisscross under the seat. That's how they make it so that the rear pipes don't have to stick out further. And they're all the same length, which worked out quite well. It's a 6-speed gearbox. I think the crankcases are made of magnesium, so it was very state-of-the-art in its day. One of the things that's neat about this seat is right now it's set up for a single rider, but by removing these knobs, this back shell pops off, and it's actually a twin seat. Most of the guys think it looks better like this, but let me see if I can get this little cover to come off. These knobs actually also assist in removing the seat, which is nice. So I think you'd agree it looks way better with the seat cowl on. So the seat removes just like a normal motorcycle seat. And then if you take a look inside here, some of the magic begins. Here's the two exhaust pipes that are the upper ports. I'll show you that here in a minute. An awful lot of beautiful hand welding going on to make those. To tip up the fuel tank, it's pretty easy. You need this specially designed stick. It actually came with a prop rod, but that's been lost over the years. So all you have to do is pull this little pin up front. It's got a full tank of gas, so it makes it a little bit heavier. And then this tips up here. And I've made this little stick, which does a pretty good job of holding it. This one also has a quick disconnect here, so we can tip it up even further. So you can see now these are the top two cylinder heads. And you see this is at an angle about the same as the stick. And the forward cylinder heads are at a different angle, and we'll show you those here in a minute. Not a lot of room to spare, as you can see. It is fairly easy to get to the spark plugs. Air cleaner system is here, and then on each side there are two carburetors. It's quite interesting. The lower carburetors are fed by case reed valves, which go directly into the crankcase. Because of lack of room, the upper cylinders have reeds going directly into the cylinders instead of the crankcase. The front part of the engine has a counterbalancer on the front crankshaft, but there's no counterbalancer on the second crankshaft. The bike runs very smooth. This is your choke lever right here. It's kind of neat. It's got four little cables going to it. So when you pull this lever, that sets the choke on all four carburetors. There are 26 millimeter Mikunis. So now, so you can see more of the engine, I'm going to pull off the bottom cowling and then the two side cowlings, and we'll get a good look at what's going on inside. So now we remove the cowlings. We've got the tank flipped up, and we'll try and get some close-ups here of just the way the engine's laid out. Scott, if you want to bring the camera in closer here. So you can see one set of cylinders is at approximately at this angle, and the other set is at this angle, roughly. In between, they both have their own separate crankshafts. Then they were geared together. So it was a very compact engine. If you come down underneath, you can see part of the advanced suspension for its time was to put the shock absorber for the rear end way down here. And you can see it was also adjustable. It also had the advantage of lowering the center of gravity. And again, you can see more of the beautiful handiwork on those JL pipes. Come up to the other side, we'll walk around the engine and we can see more of the carburetors. I removed the air filter plenum. This, of course, is the water pump here. And the electronics are mounted up here to the right and throughout the bike. This bike had the Yamaha power valve control system, which increased the throttle performance. The factory bikes, the OW70 and 71s, actually had rotary valves, and they didn't have the power valve system on some of them. Some of them they did. So very high tech for its day. So on this side, you can see I've pulled up the left airbox plenum, and you can see the two carburetors are mounted one on top of the other side by side. They actually feed in and go to 90 degree intake ports. As I mentioned earlier, the lower cylinders were fed by reed valves going into the crankcase. Because of space constraints, the upper cylinders are fed by a reed valve going straight into the engine cylinder. Obviously, rejetting is a big deal. This one's jetted pretty closely, but quite a bit of labor to get all this off to change the jets. Something else that was unique for its time is the gearbox on these was known as a cassette system, which is pretty common today, but it enabled the mechanics of the day to change out the gear ratios much faster at the track.
Let's rock!
Really fun. I could only get to about third gear,
These are geared very tall, but still moving along pretty good.
Kramer's Classic Cycles. I'm Kirby Kramer. Thanks for watching our feature on Yamaha's RZ500 V4 two-strokes. And reminds me, when I was a kid, I wanted to be Kenny Roberts, and this is about as close as I'm gonna get. If you like this video, please subscribe and hit the thumbs up button, and we'll create some more for you. Thanks again.